All right, what we're going to do is we're going to go over the basics of this course, how the course is structured and so on. I am almost positive that all of you have had me in another class. So, you know, I generally run my classes about the same. So you kind of have an idea of what's going over, but I do like to go over a few things just to reinforce them in your mind and so on. And then we'll get into the actual material for the class. All right, let's start out. You're all familiar with Canvas, I would assume. Let's start out by looking at the syllabus. And again, I'll probably give the short version of this, given that you've had me in other classes before. Sure hope the projector works in this room. I had a class yesterday where it didn't. Use my power of deduction and say you are George. All right. Here's the syllabus. The one thing I want to point out to you is that there's a lot of different ways to get a hold of me. All right. That's sort of the main point of the first part of the syllabus. All right. This is a small class. There's seven people in this class. So you by yourself constitute a pretty good percentage of the class, 14% of the class, if my math is right this early in the morning. So therefore, if you have a question, by all means ask it. And there's a lot of different ways you can ask a question. You can certainly raise your hand during the lecture and ask the question. You can ask me during lab. And then there's other ways to get a hold of me if you need some additional help. I have office hours, which are listed here. 11 to 1 on Monday and Wednesday, 9 to 11 on Tuesday and Thursday. If those don't work for you for whatever reason, like you have a job or whatever and you can't make those times, you can arrange other times with me. If you're having trouble getting on campus, we can do it via Skype. Or via a phone call or anything like that. In addition, I make my other lab available to you. I have a lab, this is Monday and Wednesday. Tuesday and Thursday, I have a lab from noon until 1 p.m. in the same room that we're in. So if you have questions about this class, you're welcome to show up on that lab as well. And then if none of those work, we can figure out something. The point is you have to meet me halfway and ask me questions. And I hope I'm available enough for you to give you the opportunity to ask the questions that you need to be successful in this class. All right? We each bear a responsibility, and your responsibility is to let me know when you're having difficulty with the material. That's a big one of your responsibilities. And hopefully let me know quickly. In other words, sometimes students will like, well, I'll figure this out. Well, that's admirable that you want to work through it on your own, but it can also cause you difficulties if you fall behind and so on. So therefore, ask questions as soon as you run into them. Here's a description of the class. And we'll get more into the overview of that as we go along. There's no textbook. Now, that being said, there's a number of resources that you can use. I'll post some of them. In addition, many of you may have used in the past Safari Books online. I don't know if you're familiar with that. There is via our library. You can log in and you can see full text versions of a number of technical books. The reason I don't have a textbook for this class is we really cover three or four, depending on how you count it, topics in this class. And it's difficult to find a textbook that covers all of them, you know, and I don't want to give you like three textbooks, all right, or two textbooks. So I decided that it would be best if I just put materials together, and there's a lot of good materials online for software development and web development, so we're going to take advantage of that. I can recommend books if you have questions, if you prefer to learn that way. And also, you can use Safari Books Online. Let me actually get into Safari Books Online. If you are accessing it from on campus, it's easy. You just click the link and you go to it. If you're accessing it off Canvas, you have to supply your library card number, which is not the same as your student number. All right. Let's see with the new improved website if I can find the library. Learning Center, technology resource. There we go. To access Safari Books Online, you can go to the library site, which is lionccc.edu/library, click on databases, click on S for Safari, and the top one on the list is Safari Books Online. And if you are okay with reading a book on screen, you can read it right here. And these again are full text versions. They contain the entire book. If you like to purchase books, you can at least preview it here to see if it's a book that is agreeable to you. But for example, if you're looking for, let's say you're looking for JavaScript resources, you could type in JavaScript, find a book, and get into that and read the full copy of the book. JavaScript gives you superpowers. I don't know if that's exactly true, but... And they show this, which we're actually going to talk about today. And so on and so forth. So this is a good resource that's available for you. And I mention this just, you know, some of you are aware of this, but I mention you for other classes as well. You know, if you want, you know, regardless of the class you're taking, if you want additional resources, or if there's a topic that you're just interested in studying on your own, this is a good place to get information. If you're on campus, again, you automatically go to it. If you're off campus, you have to supply your library card number, which is like on the back of the library card. All right. This is your class. Again, as I mentioned before, only 7 people in this class. So, therefore, you constitute a good percentage of the class, so ask questions. It doesn't do me any good to think in my head that I've covered something if no one understands it. There's an old adage among teachers that if you don't understand something, there's a good chance, if a student doesn't understand something, there's a good chance that someone else won't understand it as well. So, if 2 or 3 people in the class don't understand something, you know, you're getting up to close to half of the class that's not understanding it. So it's important that we get it clarified. So ask the questions. Ask the questions in class. Ask the questions in lab. Ask the questions online, all right, or during office hours or wherever. The worst I will do is I will tell you if you ask a question, for example, and I think that it's something that we need to review on an individual basis, I'll tell you we'll talk about it in lab, you know. Maybe you're having a problem with your assignment and the problem is very, you know, something very specific to what you're doing in a lab. I'll tell you we'll review it in lab. But again, no harm, and by all means, ask it. We use Canvas in this class. I'll post stuff to Canvas. I'll post corrections if I make a mistake in class or if I find a good resource about something or if someone asks me a question I don't get or whatever. I'll post that. I'll post all assignments in there and so on. And I'll also post announcements, you know, if for whatever reason the deadline of an assignment changes or I know I'm going to be out sick a day or something like that, I'll post that to Canvas. So a whole bunch of policies, college policies, instructor policies as far as late assignments. I'm very flexible with late assignments if I know that you are coming and working on the assignment. All right? If you're struggling with something, that's okay. You're students. You're learning this material. What I have a lot less patience for is people that simply disappear. I don't hear from them. And then around week 8, they start turning in the first and second and third assignments. All right, and again, that happens periodically. If there's something going on where you're not going to be in class or something's going to be delayed, you know, if there's an illness or some family emergency or you need to go out of town or whatever, you don't have to divulge anything private, but just give me a heads up. Say, something's going on, I'm going to be late with this assignment. And I will definitely be a lot more flexible with you than, again, if you don't give me any word, I don't see you, and then 2 weeks later you just start turning stuff in again. By all means, read through the syllabus. This class is a little different than many of the classes that I run in that this class has exams instead of projects. Again, this class covers several topics, and I think it would be hard to have a project. It would be harder to have a project. I suppose I could, but I prefer to just have exams. So there'll be a midterm and a final. And a good portion of your work is your homeworks. A good portion of your grade is your homeworks. And again, if you think about it, your homeworks, you could literally work virtually as long as you want to on that. And I know you need time to eat and sleep and all that, I guess. But other than that, you know, your homework should be something that, you know, if you are willing to put in the time, that you can get a lot of points on. And, you know, you can get all or nearly all of them. Now, one thing that happens periodically is, you know, I'll have students say, I've worked 20 hours on this homework assignment or some really high number. My homework assignments are not meant to be torture. They're not meant to be horrible. They're not meant to take up all your waking hours. All right. So if you are working sort of an inordinate amount of time on your assignments, then maybe you need to contact me and we need to talk about it. Maybe you're taking a wrong approach or there's something that you don't understand or you're spinning your wheels or something like that. So the point to ask that is, again, early on. Don't wait until, you know, you're ready to turn it in and say, well, I spent 60 hours on this 5-point assignment. It's like, well, I didn't intend for you to spend that much time on it. All right? And if you did, then maybe there's something that we need to talk about so I can clarify it for you. All right. I've sort of broken this down into topic areas. Weeks 1 through 4, we're going to spend on JavaScript. We're going to do the course overview and JavaScript. For a few weeks here, we do jQuery. We have a midterm. We have spring break. We do PHP. We might do PHP and database, depending on how the semester goes. And then we're going to do AJAX the last few weeks. All right. So really, depending on how you score it, 3 or 4 topics. The course is set up like all my courses are set up, in that there'll be a module for each week. And there's materials to read in the module. There's a to-do this week in the module. I posted, for example, an overview of the difference between client-side and server-side. Just as an FYI for this class and other classes, if you click a link and something like this pops up, just click up on this title bar, and it will open up the stuff in its own window. This is a nice overview of the difference between client-side and server-side coding, which I'll be talking about in a minute. And likewise, there is a JavaScript tutorial that is pretty good as well. The module has a to-do this week that talks about specifically what items I want you to look at in the tutorial, and so on. And there's a lab assignment. I'm going to talk about the lab assignment now. Because the lab assignment really is for you to create a web page about the main topics for this course. So this is a great place to start. This assignment, you simply are going to create a web page that has an overview of the three main topics of this course: JavaScript, PHP, and Ajax. So you're going to find information on the web, sketch out your page, create your web page, have a description of the topic in your own words, summarizing what you found, and at least three links about each topic. And then create a good web page. You've all had CISS 2.16, and you've all done web pages before, so use good HTML, use good CSS to make it look like a completed web page. You know, I don't just want a page with paragraphs and three links on it with no formatting or anything like that. You should have an idea of what constitutes a well-designed web page, so spend some time to make it look good. All right? Even though the focus of this class is on scripting, instead of the design and the aesthetics of a web page, this is a good opportunity for you to practice the skills that you learned in the other classes. So the expectation is that the pages that you develop will look like completed web pages. All right. So any questions at this point? So on to the overview of the class. I'm going to start by drawing a diagram, which I promise I will draw. What we have, 30 classroom sessions, 15 weeks, two sessions a week, more or less. I'll probably draw this diagram 20 times throughout the semester, you know, almost every class, if not every class. And I do this in almost all of my classes. And it's a drawing sort of how web pages work. And let's make sure that we understand the terms here. We have a client and we have a server. All right. The client is, and it depends on who we talk, you know, strictly speaking, it's the person and their computer or other device. Keep in mind that they could be not using a computer but a mobile device. But this is someone or something requesting a web page. And a server is a computer that provides web pages. Now, there's two words that are used a lot of times when we talk about client-server in a web environment: request and response. So we request a page anytime we ask for a new web page. So if we open up a web browser and type in www.cnn.com, or we click a link on ESPN's homepage for the NBA, or we go and do a Google search and type in our search bar PHP and hit submit, In all those cases, we're requesting, we the client, are requesting a web page. All right? So when we request a web page, we supply some information. Namely, we supply the URL or the address of the web page that we're requesting. We might be supplying some information that we enter in on a form. For example, if I go and open up Canvas, I log in, right? I'm requesting my Canvas page. I have to supply my username and password. In that case, I'm supplying some form data. And I also am supplying some other data. For example, my IP address. What's an IP address? Yeah, it's a way of referring to a specific computer. And IP addresses are typically assigned by your internet service provider. So if I connect to the internet, whoever I get my internet through has given me an IP address. And therefore, the server can know who, you know, not who, but where the person is located. Because they know if I'm in Northeast Ohio and I'm connecting through Time Warner, that I'm in Northeast Ohio, because I'm connecting through Northeast Ohio's Time Warner's network, and so on. And then there's other information, too, including like the platform. Am I on a Mac or a PC? Am I on a computer or a mobile device? And so on. So all this stuff gets sent as a package via the internet to the server. That's what I mean when I say a request. In its simplest form, the main thing that you're interested in its basic form, the main thing you're interested in is you're asking for a web page. But there can be, and there will be, other information that's sent as well. The server then goes and does its thing, whatever that may be. And we'll talk about a couple options in a minute here. And the server responds to the client. Now, it could respond to the client with a web page. All right. It could respond to the client with an error. For example, if I typed in, or if I clicked a link that was a dead link or something, you know, a web page that they deleted off the server, I'm going to get a response from the server. The response might say, error 404, page is missing, or something like that. All right. But the point is, the server sends a response, and the response is going to be in the form of a web page. And what do I mean by a web page? Well, HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. Plus some additional files like the images and etc. But the main ones we're interested in is HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. That's the form which servers respond to clients for requests. You ask for a web page, you get back a web page. Now, each of these technologies provides a certain piece of the web page. And they work together. HTML, if you remember, is the content of the web page. CSS is the appearance and the layout of the web page. HTML, I guess we could say, is the content and the structure of a web page. And JavaScript provides what I'm going to call behavior or interactivity. So these three technologies work together to give you a web page. The HTML is the actual content, the text, the links, all the stuff that makes up the web page. Along with how it's structured, in other words, how it's organized, that these links are grouped together, these paragraphs are linked together, and so on. CSS is handled for the layout. Is it in one column or two columns? Is it green or is it yellow? Those kinds of things, along with the appearance. And JavaScript is a behavior. So if I click on a link, maybe a picture pops up in the middle of my screen or something like that. All right. Now, this is how all requests for web pages work. Client makes a request, gives a bunch of information to the server, including the URL. The server responds with a web page that consists of HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. Now, and that's true of every single web page. Now, how the server comes up with the web page is another question. All right. If you go to McDonald's, all right, and order a Big Mac, what does the server do? The server goes, turns around, finds a Big Mac in the bin, and gives it to you. All right. So in other words, there's a whole bunch of Big Macs that have already been made and are sitting there and are waiting for someone to order them. And the server has an easier job at McDonald's, right? Because the server just takes the sandwich and gives it to you. Delivers something that was made in advance and is sitting there waiting for you. Now, how is it when you go to Subway? When you go to Subway, it's different, right? You go up to the server and you tell them what you want. And you tell them all the different combinations of the stuff you want. So, for example, two of us could both go in and order a turkey sandwich, but they could be completely different, right? My turkey sandwich might be on Italian bread with spinach, and I'm not actually going to eat the sandwich, so I guess I don't have to order it correctly, but you get the idea. It's going to have the stuff that I like on it. Whereas your turkey sandwich might be on wheat bread with onions and jalapenos and all that kind of stuff, right? So there could be some customization. Now, you can't do that if you had sandwiches prepared in advance, right? How could you possibly run a Subway sandwich shop with all the possible combinations of the sandwich that someone might order? All right? Ooh, that wouldn't work, right? Let me see. Let me look in the bin for a turkey with spinach and mayo. Oh, no, that's a turkey with spinach and green peppers and mayo. Where is it? It would just not work. So what do? They actually make that sandwich there on the fly for you. Someone sits there and gets your input. All right, I want Italian bread. I want turkey. Do you want it toasted? What kind of cheese you want? And so on and so forth. And when they're done, they give you a sandwich that matches exactly what you've requested. You go into McDonald's and order a Big Mac, you just get a generic Big Mac. All right? I didn't go over that example just because I'm hungry and I'm thinking about where I'm going to go to lunch, all right? It's relevant with web pages because web pages can either be static or dynamic. What does static mean in this context? When I say a web page is static, what do I mean? Yes.
Every time that you load it up, it'll always be the same.
Every time you load it up, it's always going to be the same. Unless someone manually goes in and changes it. Alright? So, what might be a static web page? Well, maybe a web page for a restaurant. You know, you go to a web page about a restaurant, you know, it might have an overview of like what kind of food they have at the restaurant and the menu and the address and the telephone number and that kind of stuff. In other words, information that no matter who requests it, they need to see. And you don't really need to see anything different. In other words, if me and you both want to go to Sorrento's, it's going to be the same menu for me as for you, right? Not going to be a special menu for me. All right, that'd be nice, but that's not the case. It's going to be located in the same place, and so on. So being prepared in advance. And they're like the Big Macs. They're just sitting there on the computer waiting to be delivered. No processing is required by the server. So these are already pre-written, prepared in advance, and contain HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. You ask for one of these static pages, all the server does is finds that page and delivers it to you. Doesn't do anything fancy. All right? And again, if you go and access it now, access it tomorrow, if I access it, if someone in California accesses it, they get the exact same page. All right? It's static. It isn't changing. It only changes if someone goes in manually and changes the code. All right? What do you think there is more of on the internet? Static or dynamic? Well, let's talk about dynamic pages first, then I'll ask that question. Well, what are dynamic pages then? Dynamic pages are pages that are created when requested or created on the fly. These would be like the subs you get at Subway. So, let's think of Canvas. If me and you log into Canvas, do we see the same thing? No. You see the classes that you're enrolled in, I see the classes that I'm teaching. What's more, if we continue to go in and access pages through Canvas, even for this class, a class that we're both in, I get to do things that you can't because I'm the teacher. I get to post assignments. I get to grade assignments. All right? Whereas you get to submit assignments and so on. But you can't create a new assignment or delete an assignment or anything like that. So we have, not only do we have different content, but we have different responsibilities and different functionality as well. If you do a Google search and type in Italian restaurants, all right, it will actually show you Italian restaurants in this area. All right. Does that mean that all the world's best Italian restaurants are located here in Lorain County? No. What it means is the Google search engine takes into account where you live and figures if you're looking for a restaurant, chances are you're looking for a restaurant within a reasonable distance. And so it will give you restaurants close to your location. How does it know your location? Well, it can kind of figure it out based on your IP address, at least approximately where you're at. So, these dynamic web pages change. They change based on who's logged in. They change based on where the person is accessing the web page. They may change based on time of day. All right. If I look up a TV network's web page, it might say what's currently playing on it. You know, if I looked at the USA Network, it will tell me what's playing now. If I come back at 11 o'clock, it will show me what's playing then. All right? There isn't someone sitting there going in and coding that change, like, ooh, change to 11 o'clock. Let me go and edit that web page. Things happen in a different way. These dynamic pages are created by server-side scripting. Server-side scripting, you don't have completed web pages sitting there. You have, to continue the food analogy, you have recipes for web pages. How do you make a Canvas page? What are the instructions? You look up in the database and find the classes that a student is enrolled in. You then make a link for each of those classes and so on. Just like a person at Subway knows a recipe for making a meatball sub, a recipe for making a turkey sub, and so on down the line. They don't have those finished sandwiches out there, but they know the recipe. and they get information from the request to complete that recipe. In Subway, they ask you what cheese you want, what kind of bread, what toppings. On a web page, there might be a form for you to put information in, your username and password, for example, in Canvas. Or you supply your IP address, which the computer can, which the server can use to get your location. All those things are input to these server-side scripts. All right. So we don't have HTML. Instead, we have code that makes or writes HTML, CSS. And this code can be PHP, ASP.NET, Ruby, Java server pages, and so on. The language might be the same, but all dynamic pages work this way. A request comes in, there's a program that reads the request and creates a web page custom for that request. Now, here's something very, very, very important to remember. If you go into McDonald's or go into Subway, you're coming out with a sandwich. All right? Doesn't matter if it was sitting in the bin waiting for you, prepared in advance, or the person made it for you right there. When all is said and done, the server delivers to you a sandwich. In web pages, the server, when it's done, delivers to you a web page. It delivers to you a combination of HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. Now that code might be prepared in advance and sitting out there and just waiting to be delivered, or that code can be created through what's called server-side scripting, which involves using one of these languages to create an HTML page. All right? You still have to know HTML, right? It's just that instead of writing the HTML yourself, you're going to write a program that writes the HTML. All right? So, one of the topics for this course that we're going to study specifically is PHP. We're going to study how to write PHP code to write web pages based on what the user enters in. Based on what the user enters in, or the user's location, or PC or Mac or whatever. So one of the things that we're going to do is one of the topics of this class is PHP, which is used to create server-side pages. Used in server-side scripting to create dynamic pages. Now, what do you think there are more of on the web? Static pages or dynamic pages? Think of popular sites that you visit. What are like the big websites on the web? There's Facebook, there's Amazon, there's Netflix, there's YouTube. Most of the sites on the web that are interesting, all right, are dynamic, right? Because the days are over when we're impressed by, ooh, I can type in this address and see a restaurant's menu. Ooh, that's pretty cool. I remember when that was a big deal, all right, that you could do that. But not anymore. People want something customized to them. People want to go to a restaurant site and see their order history. Gee, what was that pizza we got last time when we ordered? Yeah, let's go and look it up and let's get another one of them, all right? Or, gee, I've bought 10 pizzas from there. Maybe they should give me some kind of discount. It would be nice if they kept track and gave you a discount every time you bought a pizza or something like that, or get a free pizza after you order 10 or something like that. People want things that are customized to them. You know, Facebook, right? You see your timeline. You see the stuff from your friends. I see the stuff from my friends. Netflix, you get recommendations based on what you watch. I get recommendations based on what I watch, and so on. So most of the web pages on the web And most of the famous ones, most of the ones that people access regularly are dynamic pages. Google search engine is dynamic, right? It's not going to give everyone the exact same search results. That's ridiculous, right? It's going to give you search results based on what you've typed in the box, where you're located, maybe if you're on a Mac or a PC, and a bunch of other factors as well. All right? So, PHP is the server-side technology we're going to study. Now, there are other technologies, and they all sort of work the same way as PHP does. It's just in a different language. All right? Just like, you know, you can have a novel in English or French or Spanish or whatever. The basic form of a novel is the same, no matter what language it's in. It's just the specifics of the language that are different. Sort of the same thing with server-side pages, right? In concept, they're the same, it's just what language you use to create them. Now, the name of this class, I think, is something like scripting in the client-server environment. So we've talked about server-side scripting in PHP. Where does client-side scripting come in? Well, the language for client-side scripting is JavaScript. So that's another one of the big topics of this class. When you hear the word scripting, think programming. It's not just basic HTML commands. It's code that you're writing to do something, to act a certain way when the user does something. Now, in the case of JavaScript, JavaScript is code that is downloaded to the client machine. And again, this can either be a computer or a mobile device, a gaming console, anything that has a browser that can read HTML. Now, code can be executed either by the server or the client. But when you execute code on the server, look what you have to do. You have to make the request to the internet. This request actually bounces around, goes from machine to machine, till finally it ends up at the right server. All right. It's just like if you're going to drive from here to Subway. You couldn't just drive a straight line to it, right? You'd have to follow the roads to get to where you wanted to go. Think of that as the same way. You don't go directly from your machine to the server. It follows a path. All right. And the response from the server follows a similar path getting back to you. Now, in terms of how fast a computer operates, that's actually a long time. Now, we have fast internet connections these days, right? But still, if you go and type in an address, you'll notice sometimes it'll take a second for the page to load, all right? And what's happening is it's going through the internet, it's requesting a server, the server's doing its work, and then it's sending you the response back. And sometimes, it takes a second, all right? Again, on a fast internet connection, you almost don't even notice it, you know. But like in the old days, you definitely would notice it, right? Because you'd see the page stopping and waiting to load and so on. So that takes a long time, a relative long time to request information from the server. Code that already has been sent to the client can execute instantaneously. Doesn't have to wait for anything to load. So therefore, any sort of interactivity that you want to have happen quickly, actually not even quickly, immediately, is going to be done through JavaScript. Now, it's probably not going to be anything important, all right, for a number of reasons. One is you have less security. You're not going to access a database from JavaScript, for example. You don't have the capability to do that, and it probably wouldn't be good from a security function. But anything that you want to have happen like an effect in the screen, like you put your mouse over a link and a submenu drops down, that you're going to do via JavaScript because you want to have it work immediately. That's another topic. That's actually our first topic is JavaScript. How to write code to make changes to a already loaded web page. JavaScript is client-side scripting.
So client side is JavaScript, and it's used to make changes to an existing web page. Server-side scripting, in this class, will be PHP, but there's others. It's used to create a new web page. So JavaScript changes an existing web page. Server-side scripting creates a new web page. Now, the third topic that we're going to cover, just going to mention briefly, is AJAX. And AJAX is a specific method of using client-side scripting and server-side scripting more seamlessly. Talk more about that as we get to that. Before I go, I want to show examples of JavaScript, and I want to show what I mean by AJAX, just to give a very quick description of it, and we'll continue on with this discussion in future classes. Classic example of JavaScript, one that I use a lot, is menus that you put your mouse over. And all right. So here we're on ESPN's site. Notice that these links. So we put our mouse over these links. Notice it's not loading another page. We don't notice like a flicker. Like when you load a page, notice that some things come in and then other things come in. That's when it's loading a complete page. When we put our mouse over that, though, notice that happens immediately. That's a clue that this is happening client side. If you think about this, if you had to wait for your internet connection to go and redraw the page with the new menu, that would make this very clunky. So that's an example of client-side scripting. An example of AJAX is Google. Notice what happens when I start typing in something. I'm going to type in a P. It gave me the top four sites that start with the letter P. Type in H. Gave me the top four sites that start with PH. I have no idea who Philip Rivers is. Then I type PHP. It gave me the top four sites that start with PHP. Now, some of this work is being done on the client side, and some of this work is being done on the server side. Generally speaking, doing intensive things like accessing a database is done on the server side. Because, again, we don't want the client-side code to be able to access a database. The server has the resources to do that. So looking up in Google's databases, what's the four most popular things that start with the letter P happens on the server. But notice that when I do that, it doesn't refresh the whole page. It just changes that one little area of the screen. It uses client-side coding then to get back from the server what the four most popular things are that start with the letter P or PH or whatever, and uses client-side scripting to change the page. All right, so it's simply a seamless way of incorporating client and server scripting. All right, that's the one thing I failed to mention when I talked about server-side scripting, is server-side scripting is well-suited to certain tasks, and those tasks are the ones that require like a lot of processing, like database accessing. Is a real big one. Whereas client-side scripting is more geared towards doing things like you know, making cosmetic changes to the screen, making things disappear and reappear or things like that. Whereas looking something up in the database, so for example, if I search PHP, that requires server-side scripting. That's a very intensive operation. And Google does, you know, Google has its database of all its indexes of websites, and the Google server-side script does the search of the database to provide that. So server-side scripting does the heavy lifting. All right. Whereas things such as, well, we're going to make these menus appear and disappear. Well, that's just making some small cosmetic changes to an existing page, and that's what JavaScript or client-side scripting is good for. So your first homework assignment is to do some research on JavaScript, PHP, and Ajax, and create a page that looks professional that covers those topics. All right, we'll see you in lab. I will go unlock the lab, then I'll come back to get my files to post them so I can post the video.